Hello everybody and welcome to this tutorial. Today I'm just gonna go ahead and start using Hydra immediately. You can see that I have like 100,000 things open down below, but you don't have to concern yourselves with all of them. Anyway, let me just zoom this in a little bit. There we go. Full screen, fantastic. Now, I have ran a command before and I have it here. So let's just go over it, but before we do, a quick thing to do is just do a nano pass list. Excellent. So I've created a password list for myself here. Now, of course, this would be a pretty stupid thing to do if you were actually cracking a password somewhere on a website. Rather, instead, you should definitely download a password list from somewhere. There are plenty of them on the net. Just type in password list for dictionary attacks. You won't find a shortage of them, I guarantee it to you. But why should you do this then, what I did? Why didn't I just download it from the net? Well, Hydra is notorious for not doing what you intended it to do. I mean, the tool does function, the tool is properly coded, the code is fine, but because of the parameters that people tend to pass to it, especially for HTTP and HTTPS versions of attack, when you are attacking a website login form, it gets confused a lot in between what is a proper username and what are proper login credentials and what are not, because you need to provide a message to Hydra, what message that will basically, once it receives that message, it knows that the credentials are false, and every time it doesn't receive that message, it will assume that the credentials are correct. Hydra doesn't actually do anything else. And because of this, it can get confused a lot, and you do need to pass that long URL parameter for a login site. So there are some problems that can happen, and that is why it is good to create your own password list that is very short and to test out your attack. Test it out on your local web server or test it out on the server that you wish to attack. But if you can log in, if you can log into that server with some sort of visitor or guest account or something like that, just create some nonsensical account with nonsensical information there. That would be great. And see if this attack works. Try out these passwords. If it finds the right password, great. And don't just run the test once. Run it like two, four times, not in a row preferably, but over the period of 2 days or something like that, or more. And if both tests find successful passwords, then you're good to go. Then you know that Hydra is functioning fine. What you do not want to do is load up a dictionary of 8 million passwords and like 10 million usernames and start your brute forcing attack over the period of a couple of weeks just to find out in the end that you actually failed to pass right parameters. 2 weeks of wasted time. So just create a file like this. It's pretty simple. Type in nano and then space name of your file, just like I've typed in a second ago, and then you can type in whatever you want here. It doesn't really matter. Control O to save, press enter for pass list. That's going to be the name of our pass list here, and Control X to exit. You can name it any way you like, quite literally. It doesn't really matter. Let's go ahead and clear the screen there. Now what we need to do is find that command that I've used. Excellent. So it says Hydra, and then dash L for admin, space dash P for pass list, capital P, the IP address of the server, the method. Okay, so there's a difference here. The previous one was get, this one is post. Reason for that. I'm actually attacking the front login site of the damn vulnerable app with Hydra. I have discovered some of the complications inside, so I didn't want to put you through it, as you would get a lot of errors and problems around it. And generally, you will want, and that, to be quite honest, that is not a realistic scenario in the first place. Primarily because you've already logged into something, and then while you're logged into something, you want to brute force something behind, you want to brute force another login behind the login, which is, I don't know, I suppose you can find such scenarios in the world, but it is not very likely that you will encounter that. Far more likely option to encounter is the one that we are seeing here before us, and this is far more realistic anyway. So I've already attempted to log in. It says login failed. If I reload the site, I'm going to Burp Suit, so I'm just going to forward this. Excellent. So we have this DVWA. We can copy this. As I've showed you in the previous tutorial, the procedure is exactly the same. There are no differences here. But I just want to show you that you can also do this in Burp Suit in a very nice fashion. So you can go here into headers, and you can immediately see what you are requesting here. You will, of course, disregard the HTTP/1.1 request. Rather, instead, you will just copy this first part of this header. We got some hex here that's completely irrelevant to us, some params here, anyway. But you also have it here. It says get, and then you have it here, again, in the same form, but you can actually copy-paste it from here while from headers you... I don't know, it's possible, but you have to, like, cut it and do stuff to it. Here you can just do this and then copy-paste to wherever you want. Anyway, even though the method is get to call the website, we are yet to attempt a login. So if I forward this, excellent. And now I'm going to attempt a login. Where is it? Excellent. So you see here it's post. One of all, if as soon as you don't see your credentials being passed in the URL, space of your browser, it should be post, if I'm not mistaken. If they are passed in the URL, it's get, but just try some random login, just smash against your keyboard, and you can also figure it out in Burp Suit. You can use the Burp Suit in the same way I've showed in the previous tutorials, and here you can figure out that it's post. But anyway, you don't actually need to use Burp Suit. I've showed you how you can get it from page source. Pretty much that is a universal rule for any site out there. And here you can see the username fields and password fields, etc. You can even get the session ID here, but all of that you can get through your browser. Also, one more thing to note is that the security is set on high. Anyway, I'm just going to go ahead and forward this, minimize this as I don't really need it, and come back into the Hydra command. So, http:// post:form space, and then I open up my quotation marks. We need to type in /dvwa-1.0.8/login.php. Now we've actually copied this part up till here, and then I've typed in a colon in order to separate the fields. The next field that I need to use is username. Do I still have it here? Ah, no. Okay, so it's just easier for me to look at it in Burp Suit now, but can look at it wherever you like in Firefox as well. Just go ahead and forward that information, and let's go. Will this work? Tell me. Yep, there we go. Excellent. So here you see username equals. Again, you can do all of this the way I showed you in the previous tutorial, just extract information from page source, but it's a bit easier to see them in Burp Suit. Username equals, and then I would of course copy that part, and here you go. Surely enough, it says username equals. I've copied that part. Now this is the part that belongs to the website, and this part here belongs to Hydra. So you type in a caret sign, user with capital letters, and then caret sign again to close it. So this part tells Hydra where to insert username, and this is the field name on the website, equals, and then Hydra will insert values there. And percent sign, password. Again, in Burp Suit, you can see that it's actually and percent sign, and then password. Forget about this random value here. This is just a username that I basically smashed my fingers against the keyboard and attempted a login just to get this form here, and that I just to get this information here, which I can later on utilize, that I am utilizing now. So the next field is not the next field, but the extension to this field is basically ampersand sign password equals, and then we have it here again, and ampersand sign password equals. We open up caret signs, basically like quotation, but I don't know, they just said okay, it's going to be caret signs, and in between them just type in pass, like write it exactly as I've typed in here. So for password, it's always P-A-S-S, and for username, it's US user, basically, just all capital letters. You are telling Hydra, but these field names, they can I suppose they can be changed depending on what the web developer has intended them to be, but it doesn't matter. I don't know, somewhere instead of a password you can say a PIN or something of a kind, but you do need to check that with a website in the source, in the source code of the website that you can view by right click view source or use a burp suit proxy, as I've shown in the previous tutorials, and then you will be able to figure it out. I'm sure, yeah, never mind. Excellent. So pass the password, you have ampersand sign login. So let's just go to the burp suit and see what's up there. So it does really say that the extension of this field is ampersand sign login and it equals login. It is so indeed, and we copy it and paste it here. There is no need to actually do any alterations there. Login will equal login. Hydra will not insert anything there. Now the third field that we need to pass, so this is one field, colon, oh god, colon, this is a second field, colon again here, and this will be a third field. Now the third field actually is the marker field, so that pretty much, that is something that Hydra is looking for, and if it gets that, it knows that it has it knows that it's an invalid combination of a username and a password. If we just open up our browser back up again, it says here at the bottom of the page, login failed. So just try to find some message after you have typed in some random credentials, whatever, and press login. Find a message that basically says login failed. This login failed, I don't know, can be on any portion of this site, but it will be there. Don't worry about it. There is always a message when you fail to log in. So you just copy and paste that message here. If you okay, so obviously you can copy it from here, but you can also say view selection source, and then you got login failed there as well. I can't actually click on view page source here. It's still loading some messing up with Burp Suit, I guess, but it doesn't really matter. This message won't be the same. It will vary from one site to the next, and its position will vary from one site to the next. And even if I had shown you the source code for this particular site, I mean, you can see it yourselves. It's going to be in one place, but just try opening up any other site and do a deliberate fail of login. Just type in some random credentials and then do right-click view source. You will see that you get a different message. It doesn't necessarily need to say login failed. You can just say failed or incorrect username and password or something of a kind. The messages will be different. There is no direct procedure to determine this other than just by saying reasoning. Just take a look at your screen and view the message, then view the source code and copy it from there. Anyway, quotation marks closed here, space, dash, capital V for verbose output. Why capital V? I think that's for extra verbose output, if I'm not mistaken. I think that's why I placed it there, but I'm pretty sure that the lowercase v would function just the same. Anyway, if I press enter now, this is gonna go and work, even though there are just a few. You see, it actually tries them all out because the amount of threads that it's running is 16. You can increase the amount of threads by adding a dash t space. I think it supports maximum 64, 32 threads, I'm not sure. Also depends on your actual computer, how much it can handle. Anyway, it says on port 80, HTTP post form, host, and then it says login, admin, password is password. Now, it is always a good idea to do a lot of research prior to, as I've stated in the previous tutorial, prior to doing this, primarily because you won't necessarily have some sort of complex login credentials because they are rarely found anywhere, primarily because people don't bother with that. But you will want to know more about those login credentials. You will want to learn at least something before you attempt to do this sort of an attack, because if you know nothing, this sort of an attack can last for an eternity of time and you're most likely gonna get discovered by the administrator. Also, I advise you to use this in combination with some sort of proxy or something of a kind. Also, a very nice thing to do is to go ahead and click on Applications, Linux, Password Attacks, Online Attacks, Hydra-GTK. And here you have a graphical user interface for Hydra GTK, for Hydra, just GTK for graphics. Here you can choose like single target, target list, specify a port. You can specify all these things via command line as well. You can specify a protocol here. Down here you can say SSL, use the SSL, Beaverbose, show attempts, debug, complete help after failure. And at the bottom of this screen that I'm spinning now, you can see that the actual command is down there. That command changes as you change value. So I'm gonna say FTP. You can see it changed to FTP. I'm gonna say HTTP proxy, and it's also changed, but you can't see the whole thing. Ah, oh, come on. Yep, there we go. It says now HTTP proxy. The letters are pretty small here, but doesn't really matter. Just take a look at this graphical user interface tool if you're interested. All of these things you can do via command line. All of them. There's no difference there. You can specify a username, username list, password. Use colon separated files, try login as password, try empty password, try reverse login, pretty much self-explanatory things. Number of tasks, here it said by default to 16, but you can increase. You can also tell it to exit after first pair found per host if you're passing a file of multiple hosts, and you can say exit after first pair found on a global level. So if you find some login credentials for any of the hosts, just stop. Here you can specify a proxy to be used. Not a bad idea either. So it says specific. That where it says HTTP slash HTTPS URL, there you would pass these parameters. There you would pass like, there you would pass what is in the quotation marks here. Something of a kind, if I'm not mistaken. But I'm just showing you if you're this, if you're curious, so feel free to explore. And here it starts. So you say start, stop, save output, clear output. Clear output clears the screen, and save output saves it to a file. Self-explanatory as well. Anyway, I just wanted to show you that, as I said, if you are curious or something of a kind. But this is how you should use it. Use the command line tool via terminal. Always better to learn it this way. Always better to use it this way. But I don't know. If you want to play around with the graphics as well, feel free to do so. I do encourage you to do both. Anyway, I bid you all farewell, and I urge you to experiment more with Hydra. Try different parameters, try different places legally, and see how that works out for you, because this part will continuously change, and it will be different from one website to the other. This part won't change. This part won't change, but everything else within the quotation marks will pretty much change from one website to the other. This part, this part is straightforward, as I said. There isn't that much thought that you need to invest here. It's fairly easy, but invest a lot of time into figuring this part out, and once that works out, the rest is easy. It's always going to work, no problems. Anyway. Now, I bid you farewell, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.